Thank you for joining us on Bloomberg Quint. We are live from the Emkay Investor Conference, Emkay Confluence. It's a well-attended conference, as I've seen firsthand in the morning, 125 or 130 corporates, about 450 investors, large bunch of FIs coming in as well. And the men who've created this conference, the men who are at the helm of Emkay the Group, join us right now to talk about the conference, the markets, and lots more. Dare I say, the investor response, which has been fabulous. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining in. Krishna, it's an interesting time to do an investor conference. The world is probably looking for reasons for the markets to correct. The Indian markets have had not the best of earnings season, and yet an investor conference is so well attended. People certainly seem to be having the interest in India, despite all that's happening around.
So it's all the more reason that you need to connect with corporates when valuations are kind of not getting supported by earnings, and there are global challenges also. But more than that, I think the way we have organized the whole conference is that we have almost registered 130, 140 odd companies across sectors. So investors, suppose you're looking at maybe an NBFC sector, you get 10 companies to meet, or if you want to meet building material companies, you'll get at one stroke, 7, 8. So people want to do a reality check in terms of, okay, the quarter one numbers were not as per expectations. There was the GST-led disruption, etc. How have the last 40, 50 days panned out post the GST implementation, and how things are looking going forward? So I think it's more about investors who are very keen to connect with the companies to get a midterm kind of check as far as the business is concerned. As far as IT is concerned, there are concerns, etc., etc., for people who want to. So all business segments, it's more of a reality check in the time that we have organized this conference.
Yeah, it is. So Dhananjay, well attended by the corporate India as well across the market caps.
Right.
But a sense that I got from a lot of fund managers who have attended your conference, and they told me that they are really attending this conference for getting an idea of a lot of mid-sized companies and what their commentary is likely to be, because large cap commentary is relatively easily available, but the access to the mid caps is far greater here. Is that a sense that the market is also looking for stories even now, with the world looking a bit shaky, not necessarily only at the large cap space but the mid cap pocket as well? Is that the conference selling point as well?
I think for broking companies like us, we have a much wider sort of coverage, especially in the mid cap and small cap space. So we have been able to bring together a very diverse set of sectors in that space. Importantly, from a investor appetite, what is very critical to understand is that, especially after demonetization, the flow of funds in the mutual funds have actually increased. So net inflows has averaged something like 10,000 crores per month, versus an average of let's say 5,500 crores since let's say May of 2014. So clearly, there is a good amount of flow that is happening, and if you look at the flows where it is happening, the funds are largely dominated by mid-cap and small-cap names. So clearly the mandate is also towards investing in mid-cap and small-cap companies. So it is very natural, hence, that investors would have very strong interest in conferences that of the kind that we are sort of putting in place. The other aspect with respect to our MK Confluence is that we have selected themes very carefully, wherein we are sort of saying that there are certain themes that will play out over the next 2-3 years, and clearly we see that in the form of resurrection of rural demand, which we had identified about 18 months back, and we see more and more government interventions moving in that direction. So there is a whole host of things that will evolve out of that. The second aspect that we have chosen is the housing sector. This whole affordable housing and housing for all is something that is getting implemented at both central government and state government's level, and we see active participation by developers. So there is a whole buzz that is happening out there. So there are, again, you know, that's a sector that has a significant multiplier effect, not just on by way of the economy and employment, but also with respect to multiple other industries, especially in the building material space. So we have a whole bunch of companies which are actually actually adhering to this these two mega themes that we are actually presenting. So I think investor interest also gets stimulated because of such kind of focus.
Krishna, it's a long way ahead, the next couple of days as well, a bunch of meetings lined up. And in the short 3.5 hours that the conference has been on right now, what stood out for you? You know, I attended the Ratna Sahai presentation and I interviewed her as well, which went on air. The interactions that I did with some fund managers spoke about some key themes that they picked out. I heard Dhananjay say that the highest interest amongst investors is for a mid-sized company, I think dollar industry. So there are a bunch of things that are happening in this last 3.5 hours. What stood out for you?
As you rightly said, it's too early. It's just been a few hours since the conference has been on. But I think the expectations, as you rightly said, from small cap, mid cap companies is there. To stock specific, I think some of the themes, rather not stock specific, sector specific, I can talk. Some of the themes which people are trying to revisit is again on the whole building material space, which has been doing well, but there have been some headwinds post the GST. So people want to again recheck on those companies in terms of okay, is this a one quarter thing, two quarter thing, when will the revival happen? So that's one theme which is very much visible. As far as housing finance companies or NBFCs are concerned, the sense you got was that yes, the valuations are rich for most of the NBFCs. So in terms of sustainability, in terms of the and the net interest margins, etc. So people are trying to get a hang of that. So those are the two areas where I could, in my limited interaction with the various fund managers, I could see them discussing these kind of things.
What's the MK message though, Krishna? I mean, earnings haven't picked up. Let's be honest. We've been waiting for this growth to come in. And it's as elusive as it was four quarters ago, 8 quarters ago, maybe 12 quarters ago. And none of the commentaries that I've heard in my limited interactions as well talk about a hockey stick impact coming in second half necessarily. It may come about, it may not come about. What is the message that you guys are giving your clients?
See, I think I am a great believer. I always believe in the law of averages or the law, basically mean reversion. So wherever valuations go out of whack, which is not in sync with historicals or with whatever immediate projections you do, so somehow or the other stocks do tend to correct as well.
We are out of whack right now.
So wherever in stocks where you do not see earnings supporting, you need to take a call. So we have seen that wherever and wherever valuations are reasonable, you need to look to participate in those stocks or those segments. So that's the clear-cut message that we always give out to our investors, and similarly here also, we are again asking investors to meet those companies where the obvious valuations are much cheaper than historicals or with comparatives in the segment. And those are the companies which will deliver returns. They may be out of flavor for various reasons, or they are maybe undiscovered also. So those are the companies that we obviously want investors to more focus on. And expensive companies, you have to justify the reasons, and if you're not able to find the reasons, then I think it's a question of time before they will correct.
Okay, so just before I take the next question with you, Dhananjay, where are we out of whack? I'm sure those companies are not focused here, but just taking a leaf out of your answer earlier.
Look up some of the, honestly speaking, some of the NBFCs, their valuations are very rich. Now, whether how long will they sustain, the growth so far has been very good, but there's a lot of competition, same in many of the housing finance companies, there's a huge amount of competition. The growth is not a question, but how profitable is the growth is going to be a key question, and the amount of competition which is coming into that. That's what I told all the investors that I interacted with, that try to figure that out. Do you still want to be in this segment? Because what's going to hit you when you never know, because on the face of it, valuations are rich.
Sure.
So that's one segment. Even in the FMCG companies, you always, I mean, the quarter, some of the quarterly numbers have not been good as such. Valuations are again very expensive. Now, is this just a one quarter disruption because of GST or because of raw materials, or is there a subtle change which is happening in the whole distribution chain? So many of the companies possibly were beneficiaries of a very fragmented market. And will that sustain now in an environment post GST where there is one India, one market, etc.? Or maybe what is the competition from one of the, from Patanjali and the company, etc.? So those are the questions that you need to check out.
That's interesting. So Dhananjay, then the question comes in that you would naturally have had companies in this conference where you guys see promise, if not necessarily at these levels, then even if the market were to correct, those are better opportunities for people to buy. What, while I understand the central theme of the conference is rural India and housing, I know a set of companies who come in who don't necessarily fit in those baskets, but you probably have featured them because you believe that the valuations are great and the companies have a long growth. So what's the central underlying theme of the corporates that have that are attending this conference?
See, the thing is, if you look at the conference, you know, it's a very diverse diverse set of companies, notwithstanding the fact that we have tried to, provide a central message in terms of the themes that we have sort of identified. I think at this juncture, people are concerned about earnings growth and specifically the dislocations that are happening with respect to GST.
So I think
that is something that people want to really clearly know. And whether... the disappointment that we have seen in the first quarter, if you look at it, the earnings have actually contracted. And before the year started, the expectation for the Nifty companies were roughly about 20% or 23%. Clearly, that what people are trying to assess whether the full year will be a sort of washout or will there be a turnaround. Mm-hmm. So that's what the very clear focus is. From our standpoint, the message is very clear. Valuations will be decided by the markets. Mm. And we have seen that if you go back to pre 2008 levels, averages were different. After that, it is very different. If you look at the benchmark index or even the broader market, that the valuation parameters have actually changed. I think very central to our message is that we focus on businesses where there is an upcycle.
Mm.
Right, so we have to really look at from whatever the valuations are, whether from here on, whether the business is going to be improving or will it decelerate. So sure. I think that's a very critical thing. If you have identified that ahead of the time, I think that is what your assessment should be and your communication to the investors should be.
Yeah.
And thankfully, we have been able to identify some of them ahead of consensus. So I think we have kept on pushing on those. So, for instance, HUL was at 900 or thereabout. We put that as a conviction idea. It actually has done well. Likewise, many other finance companies such as ICICI Bank, we identified as a turnaround from a stock market standpoint. That has done well. So, tractors, for instance, is a set of things that we had identified. So I think as long as we are right in terms of identifying business cycle and we are able to identify that with specific companies and stock, I think that's where our job is.
Yeah.
Job lies, and I think that's what we are sort of aiming to achieve through our research and through the conference that we are having over the 2 days.
Yeah, did you guys identify MK Financial Services? That's done very well too. But the last couple of questions, really. One is, either of you can take this.
Yes.
One thing that came out in the Ratna Sahai interaction that we did, she briefly mentioned it in the presentation, but when we were doing this interaction, she was talking extensively about the state of PSU banks and the NPAs being such a large problem. And that doesn't seem to be going away at all if SBI's NPAs are any recognition. Though the commentary I thought was positive. Either of you on how does that side of the picture turn out over the course of the next 12 months?
So I think our view has been fairly consistent, and we believe that the problems that PSU banks have or are faced with has been a sustained problem. Clearly, we wanted a far more aggressive intervention with respect to recapitalization, and there are various options that have been talked about at government level, at RBI level, and also things that have been sort of prescribed by the chief economic advisor. We think that Dr. Nayak committee report as well. So we think that central to all the problems that are the solutions that have been provided, it's the recapitalization.
Mm.
And I think it is happening slower than what we had what we would have liked.
Yeah.
So I think that is a sort of a problem, and hence the growth prospects for PSU banks will be challenged over a period of time. I think what is important is this metamorphosis that is happening within the banking space, wherein the private sector banks who are capitalized better, in terms of unimpaired Tier 1 capital, and also positioned in terms of their portfolio, in terms of how they want to grow. I think the market share of them for them will actually continue to rise. So if you look at last 1 year, I think 100% of incremental market share is actually captured by private lenders. Likewise, you will have, you know, other, as the space is being vacated in terms of market share by the PSU banks, there are other companies, other segments that will actually capture more more market share, which it would include NBFCs who are into retail lending, also maybe microfinance companies. So I think that is a metamorphosis that will happen. And also from a portfolio standpoint, according to me, since the new there will be new listing that will happening that will happen in the insurance space, the market share for them will also, from a market capitalization standpoint, will also increase. So if you look at the entire gamut of financial services, I think there are many more options that will be available now. There will be changes in the index representation, etc. That will sort of create opportunity. So I think there is a good amount of investment appetite, new things getting added. You know, you have financial conglomerate as a as a concept that will emerge. You know, there are big companies which have got good brand value and new options that are coming out of it. People will sort of lap it up. So I think things are changing. We'll have to look at our portfolio allocation that way.
Just to conclude, investors and corporates, both are very, very optimistic. Corporates are okay, 1 quarter, 2 quarter, but they foresee, or the way they hold GST, post GST environment, etc., and the momentum which they see in the economy, which was building up, then it got broken because of demonetization, and after that again because of. But the underlying, you get, they are very, very confident about the growth. I think possibly it is also a function of the market cap these companies are enjoying today. So their ability to raise money if required to grow seems to be very strong. That's the sense you get. And this I'm talking about companies basically which are more consumer facing. The guys who are doing part of the capex or cap good companies, I think they are still challenged. They are not still seeing the order flows the way it should be. As far as investors are concerned, I think to sum it up, yes, they are also worried about the valuations not being in sync with the earnings and the liquidity flows continue. But you have a whole bunch of IPOs lined up in the next 3 to 6 months. So they are very confident that the liquidity will get absorbed by these new IPOs, and valuations for the existing stocks will not rise if the earnings are not
disproportionately. Okay, can't end this conversation without one final thing. We spoke to you about things that you believe there are concerns or out of whack. What is it that you believe is prime for investors to make fresh investments in, irrespective of the time frame, whether now, whether over the next 3 months?
I think what you said about investors putting money in now,
or whatever.
I mean, so they have to have a sufficient time frame. Longer the time frame, the better it is.
True.
Because to expect any short-term returns from current levels should be, I think, a strict no. I think you have to have a sufficiently long time frame to look to invest in. And from a very short-term, from a next 6 months perspective, if your third quarter earnings are not showing a decent growth vis-a-vis the third quarter of last year, which was the demonetization quarter,
and therefore the base is low.
And if that doesn't happen, then I think in the first month of the next year or the calendar year could be a challenging month.
Oops, we hope that doesn't happen. So viewers, a couple of central messages. Watch out for companies which have a rural focus. Maybe housing could be a big space as well, and various facets within that. And if you are indeed investing right now afresh, which may not be a bad idea, but keep your return expectations moderated. They may not come in a hurry as we've been used to in the past. Gentlemen, fabulous conference. Thank you so much for taking the time out and being with us right here on Bloomberg Quint.
Thank you very much. Thank you.